Hello and welcome to this painting video. In this video, we're going to be showing you how to paint the mighty Jakkob Bugmansson XI, Brewmaster General. In this video, we'll be taking you through a step-by-step guide on how to paint this fabulous Dwaradin hero. So when you're ready, grab those brushes, shake those paints, let's get started. So before we begin painting, the first thing we need to do is undercoat the model. As you can see here, we've used Runelord brass, which is perfect for all the metallics we're going to be starting off in this video. Now we're going to start with the brass armour. We'll be using Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss as our first colour. I'm slightly going to thin it down with a little bit of water, but not too much. We're just going to coat this over all the actual armour on the model. So what I'm going to be doing here is use my medium layer brush. Just going to apply a little bit to the palette, a couple of dollops like so. I'll add one more just on the safe side. And then just probably a paintbrush worth of water. Don't normally tend to use much water when I'm thinning down shades or contrast, but for this it's fine. So once I've got a nice point to my brush, I'm then just going to start applying that to his armour. So you've got quite a few bits of armour on the torso, legs, wrists. So just take your time, work your way around. And if you're not sure, just check the box art. In some places, I'm probably going to go over areas I'm going to paint later, like gold or silver, but I'm not worried about that right now because it's not really about neatness here. It's just about getting that shade on. And there we are with the Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss now dry. What we're going to do now is move on to the next steps of painting this brass armour. So we're going to start first by using wild wood, which is just going to drop into the deeper recesses for some nice definition. After that, we're going to tidy up with Runelord brass, just on the raised details and some of those flat panels. Then after that, we'll use Canoptek alloy just to finish off with a layer here and there and the highlight too. So first of all, let's start with wild wood. So I'm just going to get a little bit onto the palette. Again, this is not to thin down. This is just to get a nice point. Spin my brush a couple of times once I'm happy, and then ready. So like I said, we're just dropping this into those deeper recesses for a bit more definition. So where you've got little gaps here and there, just drop that in, around rivets as well, just for a bit of depth. When you come around to doing the layering up later on, it will add a little bit more punch to it as well, because you've got these extra dark areas. There we are with the wild wood now dropped into those recesses. What we're gonna do now is just tidy back up those raised areas on the actual panels of the armor with Runelord brass again. So this is just what we refer to as a tidying up stage, but in some places it's more like a layer, just to add a bit more brightness and definition. With that tidy up stage now done, we're just gonna finish off with Canoptek alloy and just do some highlights around the rivets and the edges. It's a little bit lighter, so you get a lot more definition with this. There we are with the armour now completed and highlighted. What we're going to do now is move on to the next section, which is the vat on the side of the barrel. Now for this, we're going to start with Screaming Bell because it's a nice copper vat. So Screaming Bell is great for that. We're then going to use Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss as a recess shade. Then we're going to tidy back up any raised areas using Screaming Bell. We're going to hold off highlighting at the moment because we're going to finish the rest of the metallics because we're going to use the same highlight when we do that. So first of all, let's start with that base coat. So what I'm going to do is get a little bit of Screaming Bell, a little touch of water, not too much, get a nice point to the brush, and then we're just going to start picking out this nice little vat here. So take your time. As you've got the Runelord brass undercoat there, you probably won't need to do a second coat, but if you're not sure, just do a second one to be on the safe side. There we are, with the vat now base coated, we're going to use Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss, and we're just going to keep this to the recesses. I'm just going to pull some of that in like so. Usually where there's like a nice gap. You can add a bit more if you need to, if it's not dark enough for you. But for most of it, you're just trying to pick out those deeper recesses. There we are with that shade now dry. What we're going to do now is touch up any raised areas using Screaming Bell. So anywhere where I've like splodged a bit. And like I said at the start, I'm not going to highlight this yet. I'm going to wait until I've done all the other remaining metallic details before we move on to that highlight. There we are with the copper vat now done. What we're going to do now is move on to the next area, which is the silver detail. So this is things like his axe head, his tankards, and some silver plaques and bits on the actual barrel on his back as well. So we're going to start with iron hand steel for this. On the axe head and just the plaque at the back of his head, where the Bugmansson XX is, we're going to apply Griff Charger Grey. And then to the rest of the actual metallic details or silver details, we'll be using Norn Oil. And again, we're going to hold off highlighting it until we've finished all the metallic details. But first of all, let's start with iron hand steel. So I'm just going to get a little bit again on the palette, little touch of water, not too much, and then get a nice point to the brush. I'm going to start on the axe head first, and then just work to the other details. If you're not sure, just check the box up, but you've got things like the tankard here and a few little details at the back here. There we are with the Iron Hand Steel now base coated. What we're going to do now is use Griff Charger Grey on the axe head and just this little plaque at the back of his head there. So I'm going to start on the axe head first, just build it up. There we are with the Griff Charger Grey now applied and dry. What we're going to do now is use Nuln Oil on the rest of the silver detail. So just work your way around. So you've got the tankards and a couple of little vat bits at the back. With Nuln Oil applied and dry, what we're going to do now is move on to picking out the gold details. Now for this, we're going to start with Retributor Armour as a base coat. We're then going to shade with Gunman Flesh all over. Then in the deeper recesses, only on some sections, we're going to be using some Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss. And then finally, we're going to highlight the remaining metallic areas as well as the gold with Stormhost Silver. The only thing we're not going to touch is that brass armour we did at the start. So, first of all, let's start with the base coat. So I'm just going to get a little bit on the palette. Make sure we get a nice point. It's always the key part, it's always getting a nice point to your brush. We'll start on the axe head because there's some nice little details there, so we're just going to start picking those out. There's a few things to consider. You've got the axe head here to do, just some of the bits on the axe as well, the sign of Bugman's at the back, just the trim on the tankers. He's got a little dwarfy little sigil just on his belt there. Again, if you're not sure, just check the box for details. With all those gold areas now base coated, we're going to use Gunman Flesh to start off with by just shading all that gold. So I'm just going to run it over like so. The great thing of using Gunman Flesh, it's a little bit more subtle and also has a bit of a sheen to it when it dries as well, so it's not going to matte everything down. There we are with the Gunman Flesh dry. What we're going to do now is use Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss in some of those deeper recesses, just add a little bit more definition like so. Just working around that little head boss there. Work that in there, around the odd little rivet and joint as well. Don't have to go mad, just little spots here and there. There we are, that last shade applied to the gold. What we're going to do now is highlight all the gold, the silver and the copper as well. So for this we'll be using Stormhost Silver. I'm just going to start on the silver here and work my way along. Just don't need to do the actual brass armour that we did earlier. Take your time, work your way around all those highlights. There we are, with all those silver highlights now done, our metallic details are finished. So what we're going to do now is move on to picking out the wooden barrel on the back of his backpack. Now for this we're going to start with Mournfang Brown as a base coat, then after that we'll use Nuln Oil and shade over. Then we're going to use Mournfang Brown again as a tidy up, but also to pick out a little bit of wood grain, then finish off with some Carrick Stone. So first of all, let's start with that base coat. So I'm just going to get a little bit of Mournfang Brown, like so, and then a bit of water. And as always, a nice point to the brush. And then we're going to start picking out the barrel. So there's a few bits. So you've got some banding around here. So I'm just going to start on some of these planks just on the side there. And again, if you're not sure, just check the box. There we are with that base coat applied. What we're going to do now is get Nuln Oil and just apply that all over. Take your time. And if you do make any mistakes, you can just soak some of that excess up. With the shade dry, what we're going to do now is return back to Mournfang Brown and we're just going to do little horizontal stripes just to give the impression that it's wood grain. So you don't have to go too mad. Little one here and there. And with that shade being on there, that would just make the actual Mournfang Brown that we first applied look a bit darker. Give this a little bit more contrast to it. There we are with the Mournfang Brown applied. What we're going to do now is use Carrick Stone and we're just going to make some little finer little lines around the edges of the planks and also where the wood grain is as well. Just take your time, work your way around. So I'll just do a couple in here so you can see what I'm trying to achieve. And the wigglier the better actually, because it does look more like wood grain as well when you do that. With the planking now done on the barrel, what we're going to do now is move on to his burgundy undersuit. So we're going to start with Barracknar Burgundy, which is very fitting for this colour scheme. Then we're going to shade with Nuln Oil. After that, we're going to highlight using Screamer Pink and then finish off with a few little key highlights here and there of Pink Horror. But first of all, let's start with Barracknar Burgundy. So I'm just going to grab a little bit on the palette, a little touch of water, and then we're ready. You've got your sleeves, you've got the trousers, and you've of course got the collar just around his head to do. So we're going to start with the collar and then work our way around. There we are, that base coat done. We're going to apply a coat of Nuln oil to it, mainly concentrating on the deeper recesses and those little rivets just here. There we are, the shade dry. What we're going to do now is use Screamer Pink as a highlight. So all I'm going to do is just go around the edge here. It's kind of like a quilted effect as well, so just take your time. Pick out those little soft areas just around these little rivets as well. And don't forget to pick out the rivet in this colour too. With the Screamer Pink now highlighted, we're going to finish off with Pink Horror. And again, just on the extremities, a little bit finer than the last colour, just so you can see some definition and transition. There we are with the burgundy undersuit now done. What we're going to do now is move on to picking out his cream gloves. Now for this we're going to start with a base coat of Rakar Flesh. So what I'm going to do is just grab a couple of dollops of that onto my palette. And as we always do, thin it down. Now key thing, as I always say, get a good point because there's a few little details you need to avoid here when doing this. So on both the gloves he's got like a little gold bracelet on both sides. So just be mindful not to actually get any paint on there. And if you do, just tidy back up with those gold stages. There we are with the Rakar Flesh now base coated on those gloves. What we're going to do now is move on to the rest of our colours. First of all, we're going to apply a thin layer of Agaros Dunes over those gloves. Then in the deeper recesses, we're going to use a little bit of Nuln oil. Then we're going to layer back up or tidy back up with Rakar Flesh and finish off with a highlight here and there of Pallid Witch Flesh. But first of all, let's start with that thin down Agaros Dune. So what I'm going to do is get a couple of dollops of contrast medium, so let's say 3 paintbrushes worth. Give that a quick wash and a wipe. And then just one paintbrush of Agaros Dune. So it's fairly thin, just give it a subtle tone. Just mix that together like so. Load up my brush, and then we're just gonna coat that all over the gloves. I'll start with the fingers, and then just work my way around. With the Agaros Dunes mix now applied, we're just gonna get some Nuln oil and just drop it into those deeper recesses, like between his fingers and any other creases that you can find. Just add a bit more depth. There we are, with that shade now dry, what we're going to do now is use Rakar Flesh just to pick out those raised details. Kind of a tidy up and also a layer. There we are, with that tidy up stage now done, we're going to use Pallid Witch Flesh just to pick out some of the extremities. So we're looking at things like knuckles, just around the edge of the actual gloves themselves. I'm just going to do a couple little dots there like that. When I'm talking about the edges, I'm just on about this part here. There we are with the cream gloves now done. We're going to move on to painting the black details. So this is some of the banding and the leather that's featured on Bugmansson. So we're going to start with a bad in black. Then we're going to highlight up quite a chunky highlight of Dark Reaper. After that, we'll do a fine highlight of Thunderhawk Blue. And just in the odd corner, especially on his axe half, we'll do like the little dots of Fenrisian Grey. But first of all, let's start with a bad in black. So again, I'm just going to get a couple of dots of that and thin it down. Load up the old brush. And then we're ready to start picking it out. Because you've got the Rune Lord Brass as the base coat, again, you might just want to do a couple of coats of this just to build it up for a bit of strength. Take your time, try and avoid some of those other areas you painted. There we are, with all the black areas now base coated, what we're going to do now is start highlighting and in some places layering with Dark Reaper. So on his weapon half, you've got all these little diamond shapes. What I'm going to do here is actually just layer them up, leaving a bad and black in the cracks. When we get things like the band in here and also this tube just here, all I'm going to do is just highlight those raised areas. Take your time. If you make any mistakes, just tidy back up with Band and Black and start again. Now that we've layered and highlighted with Dark Reaper, what we're going to do now is use Thunderhawk Blue as a highlight. So I'm going to start on the weapon haft and these little diamond shapes. I'm just going to start working around them. So one at each side like so. And a little line here. You don't have to do every segment. You can just pick the odd one here and there. It's entirely up to you. Now that we've highlighted the black, we're just going to finish off with a few little dots of Fenrisian Grey. So on the haft again, just going to pick like little corners here of those diamond shapes, not too much. Little dot every now and again. If you do find you drop some into those recesses, just use a little bit of a bad and black just to add some more definition. Okay, just moving on to these, just doing a little dot here and there as well. There we are with all the black now done. What we're going to do now is move on to painting the ale and the froth. Now I'm going to start with the ale first. So this is going to be in the porthole at the back of his barrel. I'm going to start by picking out the actual porthole by painting that Abaddon black. Then we're going to get the nice sloshing effect that you can see on the artwork by using XV88. We're going to then layer that with Avalanche Sunset. We'll also layer Avalanche Sunset on the actual froth in his tankard as well. Then we're going to use Agaros Dunes, thin down with a little bit of contrast medium, just add a little bit of depth here. So it looks like bubbles rising to give it that nice fizzy feel. So first of all, let's paint that porthole. What I'm going to do is get a bit of Abaddon black, thin it down, and then we're ready to pick it out. What I'm going to do is just paint that. Might want to do a couple of coats just so you don't see any rune lore brass showing through. There we are with that porthole base coated with black. What we're going to do now is pick out the first part of our frothy ale. So what I'm going to do is just do a little wiggle like that. So it's almost like you're painting a hill. Have that come down to that end and then just fill that in. It looks like the actual ale sloshing in the background there. Might want to do a couple of coats of this as well. There we are with the XV88 applied for our sloshing ale. What we're going to do now is use Avalanche Sunset. I'm going to start just by stabbing it gently. By doing that, you're just going to get some little dot little effects. So it looks like fizzing a bit and it gives that kind of consistency of ale. So I'm just going to do it on the very top bit there. Just move a little bit more around the side there as well. You still want some darkness around the edge there. And also, don't forget, we've got the froth to pick out there on top of his tankard as well. With that Avalanche Sunset dry, what I'm going to do now is use Agaros Dunes slightly thinned down. So it's a paintbrush of each, both contrast medium and Agaros Dunes. And I'm just, again, applying that, getting a bit of richness as well, the actual ale effect. And most of that is just going down this bottom part here to give a bit of a blend as well. In fact, I might even put some on the top there to make that a little bit more shinier, so it looks like glass. There we are, the ale now done. What we're going to do now is move on to picking out the froth details. So first of all, we're going to be using Rakar Flesh. This is going to go on the stuff that's flowing out of the tankard, and also we're going to paint a little frothy effect inside that porthole. After that, we'll use Corax White to highlight that up, and then we'll use a little bit of White Scar just for an odd little highlight here and there, and also to pick out some of the edges on that porthole. So first of all, let's start with Rakar Flesh. So I'm just going to get a little bit. Again, as always, as I like to do, thin it down, get a nice point to the brush, and then we're ready. So the first thing I'm going to do is actually just make our own little bit of froth in here. So we're kind of just going to add a little bit coming up like so. So another little hill in the background, if you like. And you want to do a couple of coats of this all the way up to the edge. You can always neaten that if you need to a bit. And then what we're going to do here is not completely layer over, is we're going to still leave some of that yellow showing through. So I'm just going to pick out some of the bigger areas. Still showing some of that yellow, like so. Now we're going to move on to using Corax White to really brighten up that froth. So what I'm going to do is just stab it like so, here and there. So just so it looks like a lot of little frothiness building up. And then I'm going to do the same thing on the actual tankard too. There we are with that froth done. We're just going to finish off now by painting the porthole. You can also use White Scar here for doing the froth as like a final highlight. So all I'm going to do is just work around this little circular bevel edge you got here, just to give the impression that the porthole is made of glass. In some places, like you see on the box art, it's got like a little line coming like that. It looks like the light's just shining through ever so slightly. There we are with that highlight now done to the porthole. What we're going to do now is move on to the next area, which is the pressure dials. So we're going to start first with a base coat in these dials using Corax White. After that, we're going to get a little bit of Mephiston Red to pick up the measurements, and then finish that off with a little bit of Norn Oil just to shade it down a little bit, make it look a bit grotty and dirty as well. So first of all, let's start with Corax White. So I'm just going to get a couple of little dollops of that onto the palette. You don't need too much here. Still using a nice pointy brush as well. So add a little bit more water because with base paints, they can be quite thick. A little bit more water, don't want it too thick and goopy, that's right. So key thing here is just make sure we get it to a nice point, like so. There's only a couple of dials to worry about. So you've got the one, well, the two just here, and then you've just got one little gauge on the side there. So we're just gonna start by picking these ones out. You can thin it down a bit more if you just wanted to wash inside, but you'll have to do a couple of coats of that. And if you do get some on the edge, like I've done there, wipe it with your finger or just reapply some silver. There we are with that Korax white now base coated. What we're going to do now is use Mephiston Red to pick out some of those measurements. So I'm just going to do the one on the side here. It's been a nice easy one. It's just like a little bit of a level. So I'm just going to do like a half, well, probably a third of it in red. It's almost working its way up the level, like so, like a thermometer. And then on one of these, you've got like a little actual groove on the top of this one. And this one here, you just need to do a little triangle. So we'll do the triangle first. There we are with the red now applied. What I'm going to do now is just apply some Norn oil, just add a bit of definition to the edges of the dials and also those little readouts in the centre as well. Just drop them in. Once it's dry, you'll get a nice bit of definition. Just get a bit more. Do this gauge on the side as well. With that shade dry, our dials are now done. So what we're going to do now is move on to the next section, which is his skin. Now we're going to start with Bugman's Glow as a base coat, which is also a nice apt name for this character as well. Then we're going to use Cadian Flesh Tone as a layer, still maintaining a lot of that Bugman's Glow in the recesses. Following that, we'll use Gulliman Flesh, just to help blend those two together. Following with a tidy up of Cadian Flesh Tone, just on some of the raised details, and then a nice edge highlight of Kislev Flesh. And finally, we'll use Volupus Pink to give him a nice ruddy effect around his nose and lips. So first of all, let's start with Bugman's Glow. So what I'm gonna do is just get a little bit to the palette. And you might wanna do a couple of coats here, because obviously you've got that rune or brass undercoat. So he's got his big bold head to do, his nose, and don't forget his lips as well. That base coat applied, what we're gonna do now is start layering up using Cadian Flesh Tone. So this is picking out all the raised areas while still leaving Bugman's Glow in those deeper recesses. That layer now applied, what we're gonna do now is use Gulliman Flesh just to help tie some of those colors together. So I'm just gonna coat this all over. It's been thinned down. So one paintbrush of Gulliman Flesh and two paintbrushes of Contrast Medium. This is just gonna be thin enough to give you a nice blend, but not overpower the color too much. Now that Gulliman Flesh is dry, we're just going to reapply some Cadian Flesh Tone just to some of the extremities, just to add a bit more definition. Not too much, mainly around the nose, the ears, the brow. Now that we've tied up with Cadian Flesh Tone, we're just going to start highlighting with Kislev Flesh. Again, a little bit finer than the previous stage. So just like little lines here and there, just to add some definitions to his wrinkles and all that very characterful face he's got. So what I'm going to do now is just finish off the skin by picking out his nose and lips. I've got Volupus Pink here, and I've thinned that down with two parts Contrast Medium and one part Volupus Pink. Once that's dried, it'll just give it a bit of a pinky hue. There we are with the face now done. What we're going to do now is move on to painting his beard and eyes. Now we're going to start with a base coat of a Abaddon Black. This is both for the beard and also picking the eye detail out as well. Then we're going to move on to concentrate on the beard. First of all, we'll do a highlight of Dawnstone on the raised areas of his beard and then just tone that back slightly with a little glaze of Norn oil over the top. Then we're going to concentrate back on the eyes by picking them out with Korax White and then just pick out the pupil with a little bit more of Abaddon Black. But first of all, let's start by base coating those areas. So I'm just going to get some Abaddon Black, a little bit of water. And for this, I'm definitely going to make sure I get a nice point because we've done a lot of hard work now, getting all that skin and all that armour done. So I need to be super neat at this point. So what I'm going to do is just take my time and just do a couple of thin coats of this. Just work your way around. There we are, the black area is now base coated. What I'm going to do now is use Dawnstone to start highlighting the beard. So we're just going to do like little streaks down like so, and when we get to his moustache as well. So obviously leaving lots of black in the recesses. Take your time, just work your way along. If you do make any mistakes or the streaks are too thick, just reapply Abaddon Black and try again. There we are with those highlights done on the beard. We're just going to knock them back ever so slightly by applying a thin shade or almost a glaze, if you like, of Norn oil. So I've applied a little bit of water to this, so it's just like one part water, one part Norn oil. What it will do is just knock back the brightness of that Dawnstone. There we are, with the beard now done. What we're going to do now is move on to picking out his eyeball. Now for this, we're using Korax White. I want to do a couple of ghost strokes. He's only got one eye because the one's like obviously got scars on it. It's slightly closed. So just take your time and move your brush slowly in. Now another thing to do is also thin the white down a little bit more for two reasons. One, it just makes it easy to apply. And also it won't dry on your brush as quickly. I'm just going to turn him on his side quickly. This might be a little bit disorientating, but I can just get further into the side of the eye like that. There we are. There we are, the eyeball picked out. What we're going to do now is just do his pupil. And again, using a bad and black, and I've thinned this down as well, so it won't dry so quickly on my bristles. I'm just going to do a little line, move in slowly, and then just do my little dot. There we are, like that. And there we are with the eye now done. We're going to finish the model off by basing him. Now we're going to start first of all by using Astro Granite, which we're going to apply all over the base. I'm also going to apply it to the stone he stood on as well, just to keep it nice and consistent, and it means it's the same colour as well. And it'll add a little bit of texture too. Once that's dry, I'm going to use Wildwood, which I'm going to coat all over to give it a nice natural dirty feel to the base as well. Then we're going to do a dry brush of Dawnstone and then a final dry brush of Carrickstone. First of all, let's start with that basing. So I'm going to use my trusty texture tool. I get the large scoop side there, get a bit dolloped on, and then I'm ready to start dolloping that onto the actual base. So what I want to do is just place a little bit here, like so. And then I'm just going to use my spatula tool, if you like, just to start moving it around. Now, when we get to things like the axe head, obviously it's key, and his feet as well, so you just use this smaller side. So what I'm going to do is just start applying that on, and I'll use an old base brush just for this area around here where the stone is. And you probably want to leave this to dry for around about an hour once it's all applied. There we are with that texture now dry. What we're going to do now is use Wildwood and apply it over the texture. Now it's up to you how neat you want it. You can have it straight from the pot. I've ever so slightly thinned mine down with a bit of contrast medium, just so it's not too strong. Just let that soak into the cracks, and as it dries you'll see more of the grey show on the raised areas. There we are with the Wildwood now dry. What we're going to do now is move on to doing some dry brushing. So if you've not done this before, the idea really is to get pigment on your brush, wipe it off, but it still leaves traces of it. So the colour we're going to use for this is Dawnstone. Now normally you'd use a dry brush, because it's quite a small detailed model, I'm going to use an old medium base brush, just because it's got a nice little point to it as well. So I'm going to grab that brush and I'll load it with some Dawnstone. So what I'm going to do here is just get some Dawnstone on my brush and then I'm going to wipe it off. Now I tend to do circular motions and crisscross motions like this. What this does is it removes any pigment that's buried deep in those bristles, so you're not going to end up having a big blodge on your actual model when you start doing it. So once I've done that, I'm just going to do a little check here, still see some Dawnstone, and then we're ready to start applying that to the model. So all I'm going to do is just go back and forth like so, and as you can see, starting to pick out those raised bits of texture with Dawnstone. Just work your way around, every now and again just keep going back down, loading up with some more Dawnstone and then wiping it off. There we are with that Dawnstone dry brush completed. We're going to finish off with a little bit of Carrickstone as a dry brush as well, just following the example we said previously, just to pick out some of those raised details. With that done, all you need to do is paint the rim of the base, and for this one we're going to use Steel Legion Drab. And there we are with the base finished. Jakkob Bugmansson, Brewmaster General, is now painted and ready to bring joy and merriment to all the troops around him. Now there's a couple of things to remember when painting this model. Firstly, when doing any edge highlighting, take your time and try and keep a nice sharp point to your brush. When using shades, try not to overload your brush too much as it can quickly run out of control. If you do find that happening, just use your brush to soak up any excess. And also when using metallics like we did at the start of the video, once you've done all that, it's just worth changing your water so it doesn't taint any other paints that follow. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this video. I hope you enjoy painting Jakkob Bugmansson Brewmaster General yourself, and we'll see you again soon. Bye bye.